So now we embark upon the most consequential, important week in history, that's all. So, are we ready? Of course we're ready. Because why? We have this tool, which the Holy Spirit just gave me this evening, which is my perfect ideal sanctuary, with every detail flawlessly complete, is already here right now. Our perfect ideal sanctuary, with every deal flawlessly complete, is already here right now. Our perfect sanctuary is already here right now. Our perfect sanctuary is right here right now. Our perfect sanctuary is already right here right now. Okay. Welcome to the video. As we embark upon this most important week in history, there's so much right now coming out on September 23rd that it's not even going to get into it. It's just crazy, the amount of subliminal, embedding, the embedment of this date, going back now, looking back in hindsight. 266 day, 266 pope. Right. Okay. So, but we're interested in sanctuary, taking the refuge, sanctuary. So our perfect ideal sanctuary, with every detail flawlessly perfect, is already here, right here, right now. It's already here. I remember the way we practice this. I can, I will, it's already done. So, we can have our sanctuary, we will have our sanctuary, we already have our sanctuary. Get this? So we can have a perfect sanctuary. We will have a perfect sanctuary. Our perfect sanctuary is already here, right now. Okay, you see how that we practice? So what we have is right spiritual practice. This is what we take refuge in. We are told that the mind is all powerful, that spirit is complete sovereign, and so we have to learn to use our mind properly. And this is one of the ways that we do it, is aligning our expectations, and we insist upon it with great determination and insistence that our perfect sanctuary is right here, right now. Our perfect sanctuary is right here, right now, with every last detail flawlessly complete, and ideal for us, our ideal, perfect, sublime sanctuary, with every deal perfectly and flawlessly complete, is right here, right now, right here, right now, right here, right now, right here, right now. So we're not going into this week petrified at all, are we? No, we're not. We're going into this week with great assurance and great affirmation. Our perfect sanctuary is already here, right now. It's here, right now. Insist upon that. This is what this does. It aligns our expectations, and we experience what we expect. Expectations is the road that paves our future. Our expectations are the paving stones of the road that we travel down. So we're putting down these paving stones, these beautiful paving stones, things. These paving stones are now our sanctuary. Our sanctuary is here right now. Right here, right now, right here, right now, right here, right now, our flawlessly complete sanctuary. Our perfect sanctuary is here right now. Our perfect sanctuary, with every detail flawlessly completed, is right here, right now. So we're not stumbling into this week at all. Not at all. We're going full blast into this week with much greater power than those who want to pull us into delay. Of course, delay is the effort to try to make pretense permanent, to get free of the continuity threat fear that we have by making pretense permanent. And we say, well, okay, oh, we don't, then we can't stop pretending. So there's no continuity fear there. We'll just keep pretending. This is, you know, the crazy, 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 craziness. And this is what continuity fear advises us. And the Holy Spirit says, no, advises us differently, saying, no, that will never work. And we have to evaporate our continuity fear. So we're taking refuge from this massive marketing campaign that is going to be unleashed upon us starting this week. It's going to be, now, we were in church today, and the bulletin had this special section on how we need to support, you know, the ex-Pope Emeritus, Pope Francis, I call him, as again, I've excommunicated the Pope with apostolic authority. Who has authority to excommunicate the Pope? Well, an apostle, Jesus, has the authority, actually. And so I have that apostolic authority. I mean, an apostle is someone who's very close to Jesus, who understands Jesus' teachings, who has met with Jesus, who's actually met with Jesus, learned under Jesus' teaching and tutelage. That's an apostle. And the apostles have the authority to say, you know, no, this Pope is not shepherding the properly, not the good shepherd, so excommunicated him. So the Pope Emeritus Francis, Pope Emeritus, the excommunicated Pope Emeritus Francis, is coming to the United States very soon, probably Tuesday the 22nd, I believe. And there's this huge, huge worldwide global marketing campaign that is going to begin to be shifted into high gear, and tremendous pressure on everybody through emails, through social media. You know, it's just going to be a blitzkrieg. It's the biggest marketing campaign in history. The most intense pressure ever seen on this planet is to get with the Pope and the President. Support the Pope, who supports the President, who has, we have this agenda. This is how we're going to pave the road that we walk down. We call it our future. This is our expectations. This is what we want. This is what we expect from you. Okay, and so fall in line. Be a paving stone. This is pave the road of our expectations. Well, knowing that that road they're going down is a disaster, it doesn't work. It may start out really wonderfully, seemingly like optimism, but you know, quite soon it's like, uh-oh, this is big trouble. The road of making pretense permanent is a futile road. It's a dead end. It's from the very outset, it's a dead end. We can tell you right now, it's a dead end. We don't want to go down any more dead end roads. We've been there, done that. It's enough. So we're taking sanctuary, meaning taking refuge means we want to be insulated from this marketing campaign. That's what it really means. We want to be insulated from this marketing campaign, because the marketing campaign is designed to crush all resistance. And why should we subject ourselves to that? We already know we don't agree. We're not going to agree. So why even be bothered by it? There's no point to it. We're not going to accept it. And all we'll do is create a great deal of conflict and struggle and frustration with it. And it's for all to no avail. It's futile. So we want to sidestep this. So people say, well, how do you take refuge? How do you do that? Well, right spiritual practice. Align your future with that. Align your future with that. I will. I've already done it. I can take sanctuary. I will take sanctuary. I've already taken sanctuary. I can take refuge. I will take refuge. I've already taken refuge. Use your mind. Your mind's very powerful, as I've been experiencing when I do the practice of I am now. I am now. I am now. It seems as though my experience, for instance, animals don't really recognize you as some corporal form, you know. No, time, space, process, and form. You seem to become faint to time, space, process, and form by insisting that I am now. I am not. I don't need any time. I am now. So this is how powerful the mind is. So when we insist on sanctuary, we'll get sanctuary. I can take sanctuary. I will take sanctuary. I've already taken sanctuary. And we just want to, you know, sidestep this marketing campaign. Since we're not going to buy it anyway, why feel harassed by it and get into clashes over it and be, you know, why be pelted with a severe storm? it doesn't help anybody. It's a lose-lose situation. So we want to be in a win-win situation. Let's take refuge from it. So I can take refuge. I will take refuge. I've already taken refuge. Our perfect sanctuary is already right here, right now, with every last detail flawlessly complete. Every last detail flawlessly complete. Our perfect sanctuary is already here, right here. It's already right here, right now. It's perfectly functional, with every detail complete. Every last little detail has been flawlessly carried out. It's flawlessly present. So our perfect sanctuary is flawlessly present right here, right now. Our perfect sanctuary is flawlessly present right here, right now. It's already present right here, right now. So our perfect, ideal, flawless sanctuary is already here, right now. And believe it. Don't ask for it. That's not spiritual practice. Believe it. So it is right here, right now. There's no question about it. See, this is the power. This is how the mind really works. The mind petitioning for something. What is the mind? Is all powerful. What is it petitioning? What could it be petitioning? It's some other power that's preventing the mind from being all powerful. This is ridiculous. So the mind has to act as if it's what it says goes. So it says, hey, our sanctuary is already here. It's already right here, right now. It's already right here, right now. There's no question about it at all. Our flawlessly complete, perfect sanctuary, with no detail left undone, in immaculate readiness for us, is already here for us, right here and right now. So we keep emphasizing this is right mental, right spiritual practice, using the mind to assert that what we want, it's here. It's here right now. There's no time gap. There's no process gap. There's no time-space gap. There's no space gap. It's not over there. It's right here, right now. It's not some later date. It's right here, right now. We don't have to wait for some process. It's totally and flawlessly complete right here, right now. And it doesn't have, the form aspect of it is, it doesn't have to go through any growth. It's the completeness of it, the fullness of it. It's all perfect right here, right now. Time, space, process, and form is not involved at all with the mind. It is just a delaying tactic, actually. We just want to believe in delay. We want to believe, so we believe, oh, well, the mind is subject to time, space, process, and form. No, it is not. No, it is not. Whatever it wills is so. So perfect sanctuary is available right here and right now. Perfect sanctuary. Our perfect, flawless, ideal sanctuary is already here. It's already here. Right now. It's already here. It's already right here, right now. It's already right here, right now. It's already right here, right now. So this is a very powerful way to align yourself with sanctuary. People wonder, well, how do I find it? Where? What do you mean? You find it? What do you mean? It's right here, right now. Keep asserting that. Keep asserting that it's right here, right now. You can say my perfect sanctuary or our perfect sanctuary or just perfect sanctuary. The perfect sanctuary that I'm asking for is already here, right here and right now, with every last little detail perfectly accounted for. It's absolutely perfect. This is the absolute perfect sanctuary that I really want. This is the absolute perfect sanctuary with every little detail accounted for. which is what I really, really want, is right here, already right here, right now. The absolute, flawless, perfect sanctuary with every little detail accounted for, that which is what I really, really want, is already here, right now. It's already here, right now. It's already right here, right now. It's already right here, right now. The flawless, ideal, perfect sanctuary with every little detail perfectly accounted for is what I truly, really want. And it is already right here, right now. Already right here, right now. Already right here, right now. And say this with assurance, not doubt. As much as possible, believe in what is being said now. Use your faith in the right way and say it absolutely is here right now. Right here, right now. There's no question about it. It's what we really want. It's what we expect. And therefore, it is. We can even say, I'm already abiding in the perfect sanctuary. And I've already taken sanctuary in our perfect sanctuary with every detail flawlessly present. I've already taken sanctuary right here, right now, in the perfect sanctuary. I've already taken sanctuary right here, right now. I've already been blessed by perfect sanctuary. So it's very important to not allow time, space, and process and form to be incorporated into any petitioning or prayer or anything we do. We must insist that whatever we're asking for, it's already here. We already have it. We already have it. The fact that this is what we really want, it means we already have it. So I already have perfect sanctuary. I've already taken perfect sanctuary. I can, I will, I've already taken perfect sanctuary. With every detail flawlessly worked out, exactly the way I want it. It's ideal, it's flawless, it's perfect. I've already taken sanctuary in an ideal, perfect, flawless sanctuary. I've already taken refuge in an ideal, perfect, flawless sanctuary, which is exactly what I really want. So you keep working on this, you see. There's many ways you can assert this. Now, you don't get this in church, do you? No, let me tell you this. The church mass, Catholic mass, and of course Catholicism is at the very center of the world stage right now. It's a very, very big deal that's going on. And it was the worst mass ever. It was terrible. The whole mood of everybody, the band was horrible, worst ever. I mean, it was just, I think people are just like, someone mentioned to me, they said, everybody's sick, and they're missing, or they're sick. So it was all different people. It was really weird. The whole thing was just like, ugh, terrible. So there's some sort of great heaviness resting upon everyone, actually. You didn't get the feeling like, you know, this had some sort of, you know, it didn't reach us. Oh, boy. And do they really teach you how to pray? I mean, it's like kindergarten, actually. You know, we can't stay in kindergarten forever. This is something the church has to understand. We cannot stay in kindergarten forever. Come on. We've got to graduate through the different phases, right? And so you have to learn how to use the mind properly and align yourself with truth and understand the continuity of fear, how to manage your success and all this. You know, one thing that they rarely ever talk about is the Holy Spirit. I've noticed this. It's about the Old Testament and the prophets or the Psalms, then it's about the apostles, usually Paul, you know, some letter or something letter, and then it's about Jesus, about some teaching. He said today, this one, well, be like the little child, you know, they were saying, who's the greatest among me? Jesus says, be like this little child, you know, and then they tried to give an explanation, which was completely missed the point entirely. They were arguing about status, and Jesus is saying, hey, look, you need to be like this little child. Of course, little children are not really that interested in status. They're not thinking about what's my status in the world. You know, they're just enjoying the flow of their experiencing. So Jesus says, you need to be like this. You know, you cannot be hooked into pursuing status, because everyone has equal status in the kingdom. But you know, they keep trying to interpret, you know, this Bible stuff, and they're never right about it. They miss it every time. I'm just like, wow. You know, you just don't get Jesus' teachings. You haven't been listening to the Holy Spirit. They don't emphasize the Holy Spirit. Big mistake. Because why? Because the Holy Spirit's successful. Everyone's afraid of success. This is the continuity fear. It's so severe that most of us say, well, I'll go to church, but you know, I don't want to really make any real progress. No. It's too frightening for me. Just help me kind of go into a waiting pattern, you know, and maybe when I die, everything will be fine. But I don't really... And this is what you get. You don't get real success. You don't get any momentum there. You just don't. There's no momentum there. Everybody just kind of sitting there like, I just hope I die one of these days and go to heaven. I don't know. that's not where it's at. It's, you know, got to start somewhere, which is fine. You got to start somewhere. So, we head into this all-important week with a full head of steam. Already focused on, we need to avoid this marketing campaign. We know what's coming, the marketing campaign for the New World Order. And they've lumped together all these issues into kind of a new religion, actually. And they might, you know, they'll market it whenever, whichever way is most effective to market it. And they're going to put pressure on everyone. They want everybody throughout the world to support their agenda. And they hope that, you know, that they hope through the United Nations, for the nations of the world, to draft some sort of charter which gives this some kind of global bureaucracy power over, you know, over the sovereign laws of all nations. This is what they're really aiming for, is an agreement that they will drop the demand, the law, the sovereign law of their countries will be subservient to the international United Nations law, which the U.S. president will be put in charge of. He's already been put in charge of a global police force and infrastructure to you know, cut down on so-called terrorism. So the Pope is here to give support to that. That's what the Pope wants. The Pope knows that he needs secular authority to go along with this agenda, so this is what they're up to. But we know we need to avoid this marketing campaign, because it's really designed to pull us into a New World Order religion, which it believes that we're human, and that therefore our pretense is real, and therefore it's permanent, and then try to automate the whole thing through artificial intelligence. This is what they're really pushing for. This is what the continuity fear is advising everyone who listens to it. And the Holy Spirit's advising just the opposite, saying, hey, avoid this marketing campaign. Take refuge from the marketing campaign so you're not pressured by it. And keep going full blast ahead to the vision of oneness and ultimately the death-free realm, which will finish off. The continuity fear will finally be fully evaporated in this way. But the gap that opens up between those who are aware of this and are not, it just seems like, you know, just vast. People don't even know continuity fear. They have no idea what you're talking about. The death-free realm, they don't have any idea what you're talking about. The great teachers, they don't really understand that. They just, you know, it's just across the board. There's no reason. The power of reason is so powerful, because you can work on anything with it, but they just go kind of piecemeal. Faith with this, faith with that, a piecemeal, there's no reason to it. It's just they think maybe this will work. I hope this will work. So you cannot teach, you cannot get momentum if there's no reason. You cannot actually produce any momentum. Whatever momentum seems to be there is given up like this, you know. It's just capriciousness seems to be in charge. So the only way to gain a real momentum on the spiritual path is to truly develop your reason in listening to the Holy Spirit. Consider what it says. Consider what it's showing you, how it guides you. Keep on clarifying, clarifying, clarifying. More and more reason, more and more reason. And then you can keep apply that to everything, every situation. Apply it to the totality. And you keep making greater and greater momentum. So, our perfect sanctuary is already here right now. It's already completely finished. It's absolutely complete down to the last detail. Our perfect sanctuary is absolutely, flawlessly complete down to the tiniest detail. And it's right here, already right here, right now for us. It's already right here, right now for us. You know, absolutely insist upon it. Your mind insist upon this. Our perfect sanctuary, flawlessly complete down to the tiniest detail, is already flawlessly complete down to the tiniest detail, and it's already right here, right now. It's already here right now. It's already here right now. So again, our ideal, perfect sanctuary, complete, flawlessly complete down to the tiniest detail, is already here right now. It's already right here right now. It's already right here right now for us. Already right here right now for us. Our perfect sanctuary, complete down to the flawlessly complete down to the tiniest detail, is already right here right now for us. Now, we're not speculating, we are asserting that this is true. This is a fact. And it doesn't matter if others aren't aware of it, but they don't want to be. If they don't want to be aware of it, that's their choice. Their perception will not allow them to be aware of it. But we've decided to be aware that our perfect sanctuary. I am absolutely perfectly aware. And have already taken refuge in our perfect sanctuary, complete down to the flawlessly complete down to the tiniest detail. I've already taken refuge in it. It's already here right now. I've already taken refuge in it, and it's flawlessly complete down to the tiniest detail. Everything is perfect down to the tiniest detail. Everything is flawlessly perfect here down to the tiniest detail. Is exactly what I really want. And it's already here, I've already taken refuge in it. I've already taken refuge in our perfect sanctuary. So we're breaking the ice on this, which we need to do, going into this most important 21, 22, 23, and Wednesday, 24, 25, Friday, 26, 27, and then a week from Monday is 28th, which is the blood moon. So the next 7-8 days, they'll say, most important days in history, no question about it. This is the tipping point. This is the tipping point. This is where the impetus for the marketing campaign, this is where the marketing campaign gets its impetus from. See, what we're really threatened by is the marketing campaign that's coming, but it gets its authority from this week. This is why this week's so important. It gets its authority that way. Now, there's already been centuries of preconditioning here on this planet to get everybody to go along with it. So it's easy for most people to just go along with it, you know, but not everybody has been allowed that indoctrination to take place. They said, hey, wait a minute, there's more to it than we're being told, you know. There's a deeper agenda. Of course, the continuity fear has the agenda of making pretense permanent, and then saying, what continuity fear, you know, is when we don't have to change, we're now human, you know. There's no more pretense. Uh-oh. There's no more pretense. We're already human. Okay. Everything's fine. Yeah, so our perfect sanctuary is already here, right now. Our perfect sanctuary is already here right now. Our perfect sanctuary is already here. I've already taken refuge in our perfect sanctuary that's here, already here right now. Our perfect sanctuary is already here right now, and I've already taken sanctuary. Already taken refuge. I've already taken refuge. Done deal. See, this is right spiritual practice. So, the stress of the time is how we're reacting. Right spiritual practice is how we are acting, because we're familiar with it. Everybody is taking refuge in what they're familiar with. This is how it always works. Familiarity is the key. I've been preaching this my whole life. And the intellect, of course, never gets it. It says, no. I just tell me the answer, and that's it. Well, the answer is familiarity. Oh, okay, I got it. You got it, but are you familiar with it? Well, sure, I got it, so I must be familiar with it. We mean a total familiarity. When the stress is most severe, where you feel most threatened, what are you most familiar with? Where do you see your safety? In the intellect? No, in right spiritual practice. So those who go, yeah, intellect, yeah, I got it, you know, they're just saying, I feel my safety in the intellect saying, I got it. But we're not saying that. We're practicing. We're practicing with assertions of feeling that we've feeling that it's already here, because the mind is asserting it, not the intellect saying, I understand the concepts. I just understood I just heard the words you said, and I understood the words you said. This is not what we're doing. We are saying with conviction. We're asserting with conviction that this is so, because this is what we really want. And we practice it over and over and over to gain familiarity with it. So when the stress keeps getting, you know, worse and worse and worse, we're here saying, oh, that's okay. You know, I've already taken refuge in our perfect sanctuary, which is already right here, right now. Flawlessly complete down to the last tiny detail. It's flawless down to the last minute detail. Flawlessly perfect down to the last minute detail. I've already taken refuge in this, in our flawlessly complete down to last details perfect sanctuary that's already right here, right now. Sanctuary is right here, right now. The sanctuary that we really want to take refuge in is already here, right here, right now. It's already right here, right now. Now, I can tell you, in Catholic Church today, there was not an ounce of enthusiasm for the Pope's visit. There was no enthusiasm. The people were as dead as can be. There was something, the priest mentioned it, says, yes, our Holy Father is coming, both to Cuba and United States. If you want to go see it, you can go see it at this cinema, you know, and watch the Mass. And Junipero Serra is being canonized as a saint. And what is Junipero Serra? Is he the first, like, Native American? He's not a Native Indian American, but I mean, the first American. Well, he wasn't even American, right? He was a Spanish, right? But I remember, it's like, there's not been a lot of American saints canonized. There's something. And was he a saint? Come on. A lot of Native Americans don't think so. There's a lot of people trying to stop this from happening, because they say it's a mockery. You know, was he an able administrator? You know, maybe. And did he set up missions here in throughout California? Sure. But how does that make someone a saint? You know, I thought a saint was someone who repented and gave up all pretense and abiding in the vision of oneness. That's what a saint is. Jivan Mukti, liberated while still here in the world. That's a saint. It's amazing the standards that they have now for saint, you know, sainthood. It's very political. It has anything to do with being a saint, really. It's very misleading. Very misleading to people. And the church is desperate, because there don't seem to be any saints popping up in Catholicism these days. You gotta go back to St. Francis and St. Patrick, and, you know, you gotta go back a ways. You know, it's been a long time. They're not really popping up very, very well at all these days. Maybe Padre Pio, I don't know. Certainly, though, not, what's the lady, Mother Teresa of Calcutta, no. But they trot her out, you know, like, but no, I mean, she was a social worker, and, you know, had a lot of issues, and, but a saint, no. But, you know, they've got to find, you know, something to keep people enthusiastic, but I was the most unenthusiastic mass I can remember. People were just like, no, in enthusiasm. They're just like, so deep in their hearts, you know, good people, all of those people, very good people, let's be honest, let's be straight about it, yeah, but in their hearts, I think they're thinking, some just doesn't feel right. There's like, nothing felt right there, just didn't feel right. It's amazing, the lack of enthusiasm. Astonishing. I mean, isn't this the Pope's, is this the Pope's first visit to the U.S.? It's certainly meeting the President, addressing Congress, United Nations. This is a big, 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 big deal. And you'd think, like, if Pope John Paul II, whoever it was coming, people would be fired up, and they'd, you know, but there's nobody's fired up here. You could hear a pin drop, and people are just, I think they deep down, they realize, wow, This is kind of the end of it, isn't it? It's not going to go well. I don't think things are going to go well the way we wanted them to. Something is interfering. This is the mood. The mood was just amazing. So, it's this marketing campaign that's the storm that we need to take refuge from. This is what I'm seeing. And you will find emails popping up. People, your friends will direct emails to you. Everybody's going to be told, send this to a friend, you know. Urge them to support, back the Pope's climate control agenda, you know. Support the Pope, support the President. There's been massive amount of friends, you know, will be sending to other friends, social media, all. You know, fortunately, you know, I'm on social media, but I have no friends. I have one on Facebook. There's one friend on Facebook. I allow him to hang around because he hasn't bothered me. You know, he conducts himself, you know, in okay manner. So it's all right. But other than that, I don't have any friends really on Facebook, and same Twitter. Just, you know, 3 followers on Twitter, and the blog, no comments on the blog. So there's no social pressure on me at all. There's the Holy Spirit arranged it this way. There's no social pressure. I never check my emails. I don't email anybody. So there's just like an extreme small amount of social pressure, which is very good right now. Now, everybody has been behaving themselves on this YouTube channel. You know, not trying to, you know, pressure in certain ways. It's a very volatile, delicate time. So I allowed the comments, you know, for the most part, with you know, exception here and there in September to still be available. But everybody's been behaving very well and you know, taking it seriously. So it's all good here. It's all good here. But most people, you know, they're subject to massive social pressure. And of course, the schools will just be blitzkrieging all the students. The students will be told to blitzkrieg their parents. Their parents will be told to blitzkrieg their friends. And it'll just go, you know, and the Hollywood celebrities will be out in force. I mean, this is just a, you know, this is like an all-out type of marketing campaign that's coming. This is my feeling, a storm. To change hearts and minds, you know, towards the egoic continuity fear agenda, which they're going to, of course, advance. When you market something, you put your, you know, best foot forward. So they're going to try to get some way of, you know, marketing. So you say, this is what we're really selling you. No, that's just the it's like a tourism board showing you like the one beautiful shot on the island, you know. Oh, look at that turquoise cove. Oh my gosh, what a beautiful island. And you get there and it's just this dead volcanic island, just horrible, you know, with a bunch of mosquitoes. And so, you know, of course they're going to put their best image forward. That's what marketing does. And You know, well, it might be, you know, climate, we gotta beat this climate thing. But it's wrapped up, it's a massive amount of stuff wrapped up all in this new religion, new age religion, this new one world order religion, new world order religion. And these things will be taken as gospel, you know, as absolute truth. And of course, we have to do this. Anyone who doesn't think that way must be completely insane, you know, they're criminally insane. Of course, this is what we need to do. Of course, we have to have this thing, you know. They have this dogma, you know, this dogma that, you know, okay, what, gay marriage? Of course. I mean, it's crazy not to do that. But of course, in the Bible, we know that it's, they say that when the abomination that maketh desolate is standing in the holy place where it ought not be, that's when you need to flee to the mountains. You know, your destruction is near. So when the abomination that maketh desolate, that's gay marriage, because there's no offspring from it. There's no natural propagation, okay? There's no natural offspring from it. So it if everyone did that, you know, the human race would die out. It'd be desolate, be made desolate. It's the abomination that maketh desolate. Standing, I mean, has standing, I mean legal standing, in the holy place where it ought not be. The holy place is holy matrimony. This is, you know, obviously is seen as, quote unquote, God's, you know, mandate to propagate and keep the race going. So it's the ultimate in legally, has the highest legal standing, holy matrimony. So where gay marriage is raised to the same standing, legal standing, as holy matrimony, where it ought not be, that's the sign that the, you know, tribulation and troubles are right upon you, just about to come upon you. Well, we're right there now, right there, right now. But, you know, the New World Order takes these things like gospel. This is, oh yeah, this is absolutely the best thing possible. Of course, how can anyone think otherwise of all the, you know? It's just, they have their religion. It's a religion. It's absolutely a religion. And of course, you shouldn't be forced to follow any religion. So you shouldn't be forced to go to school because they teach this religion in school. Really, going to school is religious catechism now. It's absolutely religious catechism. Television is religious catechism. Movies is religious catechism. The news is religious catechism. So nobody should be forced to follow. They should be able to choose the religion they want, but the New World Order says, no, everybody has to follow this religion. Everyone has to follow this religion. Well, that's not fair play, is it? Doesn't sound like it to me. So we'll just sidestep this. We don't want to be harassed. You know, who wants to be persecuted and harassed? We're not going to hide in the catacombs. No, we're past that point of hiding in the catacombs, okay? Unless the catacombs are really nice. But we're able to use our mind now, saying, you know, I've already taken sanctuary in this beautiful, flawlessly complete, down to the last detail, sanctuary. It's already here right now. Complete, absolutely complete and perfect right here, right now. There's absolutely nothing that needs to be finished. This sanctuary I'm taking refuge in is totally fresh, totally complete, down to the last intricate detail. And it's already here, right here, right now. It's already right here, right now. It's already right here, right now. So we don't want to be like flee to Cappadocia and go into those underground cities, you know, like they did previously. I think we're better equipped to understand the situation right now and say, no, we're going to insist on an absolutely beautiful, lush, beautiful, flawless, down to the tiniest detail, ideal sanctuary where we take refuge in the sanctuary. We've already taken refuge in it. It's already right here, right now. We've already taken refuge in it. It's our sanctuary is already here. It's already right here, right now, and we've already taken refuge in it. And it's perfect for it. We're perfect and we love it. Our perfect sanctuary is already right here, right now. We've already taken refuge in it, and we're already loving it and already insulated and enjoying, having tremendous enjoyment of it. It's already happened. It's already happened. So don't allow time to sneak in there. It's already happened. It's already happened. It's not something we're waiting for to happen. It's already happened. I've already taken refuge in it. I can, I will, I've already done it. I can, I will, I've already done it. I've already taken refuge in our flawless sanctuary. Where everything is exactly the way that it needs to be, down to the tiniest detail. Now, this practice may strain us because we're not used to using our mind this way, but we've been practicing this quite a bit. Just now we need to apply it to the issue of sanctuary. Because I know people are saying, well, how do we take sanctuary? Well, how? What do you mean? We already have taken sanctuary. That knocks the how right out, doesn't it? Well, why? Because our sanctuary is already here, right now. That is perfect. And we've already taken refuge in it. So this is how we need to practice. It's a fait accompli. It's already done. It's a done deal. You knock the doubt right out. Knock out the doubt. Knock out the doubt. Knock out the doubt. We give thanks for our perfect sanctuary being right here, right now. And we give thanks for being able to already take refuge in it. We're thankful that we've already taken refuge in our perfect sanctuary that's already right here, right now. Flawlessly complete, down to the tiniest, tiniest, tiniest detail. Yeah, so this is really bumping into, you know, our old conditioning, isn't it? We're told, you can't do that. You can't practice like this. You can't. Well, we are. What do you mean we can't? We already are. We can, we will, we already are practicing this way. But our habits say, we haven't ever practiced this way. Come on, what? Well, it's time that we practice this way. We're out hit 101 today. Supposed to hit about 100 tomorrow. Very nice day. It's really warm. The crickets are going full blast, high intensity. They say the heat might stay through October, and as far as the warmth in the United States, it could be a very warm October. It's possible, right? But I'll tell you what's going to heat up is the marketing campaign, the pressure. And it will ratchet up and ratchet up and ratchet up and ratchet up and ratchet up. And people are going to get very enthusiastic about it. Those who are, you know, like converts to a new religion, they're very jealous, right? They're trying to prove to their leaders just how committed they are, even though they're not committed because they're new, and they're saying, well, I don't know, well, I'm not really sure if I really should be in this or not, but I don't want anyone to see my doubts, so I'm going to be super zealous about this and, you know, tell everybody what they should do. And converts to new religion are like that. We know that. But I don't need to see it. Because marketing campaigns are really very clever deception. Bottom line is have you taken sanctuary? Have you taken refuge from the storm? Yes, we have. We've already taken refuge. Yeah, we have wonderful refuge, perfect refuge from the storm, perfect sanctuary. We're absolutely protected from the storm. So we give thanks. We give thanks to the Holy Spirit for providing us this perfect refuge from the storm. We give thanks to the Holy Spirit for allowing us to take refuge in this perfect sanctuary from the storm. All praise and gratitude to the Holy Spirit for enabling us to take refuge in this perfect sanctuary from the terrible storm. See, so start to work gratitude in there. You see, it's very important to work gratitude in there. We don't wait and know I'm going to wait until it happens. No, it's already happened. When we use our gratitude, we're aligning, powerfully aligning the expectations which actually bring about our experiencing. We're aligning those expectations that it is going to happen. Why else would we be grateful unless it's already happened? Right? So by being grateful, we're reinforcing our insistence that it's already happened. So we're no longer, you know, kowtowing to time, space, process, and form, which is just a continuity fear delusion, actually. It's a pretense. It's a pretending. Everything is instantaneous. Even delay is instantaneous. If we want ask for delay, the delay is instantaneous. Right? So all this delay, that's still instantaneous. I want to delay 3 seconds. Instantaneous 3 second delay. So we don't have to like follow the marketing campaign and critique it and all this kind of stuff. We know it's coming, and the Holy Spirit already showed me. Tell your friends to support the Pope's climate control agenda. Tell your friends, tell your friends, tell your friends. Let everybody know that you're absolutely supported 100%. This is how you build the religious movement. This is dogma. Faith, you know, they have faith. This is the answer to their problems. This is essential, and it's just a cover for a massive agenda, in many 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 ways. And it gets very dark as you go along. Very dark. It's like going into a dark tunnel. So, we take a refuge from the marketing campaign. This is what brings our peace of mind, brings us closer to peace of mind, keeps our momentum going, is we don't allow ourselves to be subjected to the marketing campaign. Like I said, I've stopped looking at the news and media, all the stuff. I just, you know, stay away from it. Limit your exposure to all marketing campaigns. But of course, the problem is if you have all these friends that are pressuring you, this is a big issue, right? Absolutely it is. And I was surprised the Holy Spirit has not, you know, brought any social media in my way at all. But then I say, well, there must be a reason. Why? Well, now I know. There's no pressuring being applied. So we absolutely have already taken refuge in an absolutely perfect, flawless sanctuary with every detail perfectly presented, perfectly appropriate, and flawless. where we find no fault with it whatsoever. We've taken refuge in an ideal sanctuary. We have already taken refuge in an ideal sanctuary that covers us, covers our purpose perfectly, suits our purpose perfectly. And this perfect sanctuary is already right here, right now. This perfect sanctuary is already right here, right now. Just holding the intensity of this. So put all your belief in that, you know, put your belief, your intention into that. And believe it. That's what I've been doing. I'm believing that it truly is already here. There's no question about it. So it's a different feeling. Instead of hoping and asking for it to be right now, I'm feeling as though it is here right now, already here right now. And I just have to get used to this fact. So I'm just practicing getting used to the fact that it's already here. Getting over the shock of realization is already here. Now, we don't want to explain ourselves to those who are trying to change our mind, you know, to marketers, proselytes, you know. We don't want to have to explain ourselves. Why should we? They're not going to listen anyway. It's a waste of time. There's no point. They're going to go, you know, forward with what the continuity fear is advising them because they haven't worked on familiarity with truth. Familiarity wins. So, if you're not familiar with truth, you cannot just grab a book and say, oh, okay, I got it. It will not work. The continuity fear is so severe, it cannot work that way. You have to be familiar with it. It means you practice over and over and over and over. It's like saying to somebody, well, you need to play this piano song really great. And the intellect says, oh, okay, I get it. I need to play the piano song real great. Okay, I got what I need to do. Thank you. That's all I need to know. So now I know. No, I know. Wait a minute, but you're not playing it. No, but I know. You already told me I need to play it, so I already know the answer. So I'm fine. But wait. You have to play it in order to be fine. You know, I get that. You know, I got it. It's obviously a delaying device, isn't it? Completely obvious it's a delaying device. Whereas the one that's been practicing, they say, play the song, they say, okay, I played it 1,000 times, I can play it again, I know, it's no problem, I'm familiar with it. So stress puts a very heavy burden on our familiarity, and this is the most stressful time ever coming up. So this is why the Holy Spirit's been urging, you know, keep working, keep your momentum going, don't stall out. You want familiarity, you want to be very familiar. So let's get familiar with this practice. Hey, my perfect sanctuary is already right here, right now. Completely, ideally, right here, right now. In its complete, finished, ideal format, it's already right here, right now. Totally functional for us. It's absolutely 100% perfectly functional for us. Exactly the way we need it to be. And it's right here, right now. And we've already taken refuge in it. And we're so grateful for this. We just feel gratitude for it. Towards this. For this. So this brings up an intense wow, and so we understand that. We'll be a little quiet and catch our breath. Interesting, the man said, everybody's sick. Why is everybody missing? Yeah, so many people are missing. It's amazing. They're all sick. Well, everyone's under great stress right now. They know that, you know, here it comes. I mean, this is it. This is what we've been preparing for so long, so long. We're finally here. We're finally at this week now, this crucial week in September. Don't react to anything that happens in September. To at least October. Don't even react to it. Don't even need to know about it. Don't even need to pay attention. I'm not going to pay attention to the Pontiff's visit or anything, you know, happens. I'm not going to be paying attention to it, God willing. And so, you know, I'm just not going to react. We're just going to practice. We already know there's going to be a marketing campaign. This is at the very top of the list. Keep in mind that the president has already stated that the greatest threat to the world, without any question, is climate change, and the Pope has stated the same. It's the top priority. The Pope has stated it's the top priority for the Catholic Church is combating climate change, and the president has stated it's the top global priority for secular power to combat climate change. So they both said the exact same thing. So you don't expect a leopard to change his spots, do you? Let's not expect that. It's not going to happen. So of course that they're going to market this. This is going to give the charge. You know, wait for the generals. You know, the troops wait for the generals to say, you know, charge, go. And once they say go, then the troops. It's like that. It's like warfare is how it happens. I mean, the troops are all lined up, but they have to wait for the general, the signal to, you know, advance. So they may, we think everything's fine, you know, everything seems fine, but there's massive armies, marketing armies amassed throughout the world, all kinds of armies, and they're just waiting for the signal to advance, the command. They're just waiting for the command. It has to come from up top, and these are the two top dogs. And when they give the command, you know, advance, then boom. Just like a battlefield, everything's quiet. Everyone's sitting there quietly, waiting for the command to engage. And when the command is given, suddenly, and the whole battle just breaks out, and it's just mayhem, just like that, you know. That's why they say the calm before the storm. One of the reasons they say that. So we're in the calm before the storm, and people think, wow, it's, you know, maybe, well, no, when the signal to advance is given, and they most certainly, you know, are going to give that command. However, the troops recognize it. You know, the troops have, they're very tuned into all this stuff, and it's amazing. You know, television repeatedly has given some commands to pressure these issues, and people automatically start suddenly pressuring you, and you know they got it from television and the media and stuff. But this is the big one. This is the big one. All the media, you know, is going to be focused. World media is going to be extremely focused on this, and they feel they're the lieutenants. You know, the media feel that they're, you know, they're part of the command structure. So the lieutenants will say, "Oh, okay, well, we got it from the generals that it's troops. It's time to advance. Now you need to start emailing your friends. You need to start on social media hammering everybody." Teachers, you need to start asking the kids, how many of you believe in climate change is an important issue, kids? You know, I mean, All right, they will do this. This is incredible social pressure. Imagine if you're just a kid in fifth grade or something, and teacher says, okay, kids, we know that the president and pope are meeting, and they said climate change is the most important thing in the world, and they're just talking about the world's going to be destroyed if we don't do this. And how many of you kids believe that climate change is an important issue, you know? And of course, the teacher's already made it plain that they feel it's absolutely, you know, all important. The kid's thinking, I want to just get out of fifth grade, you know, and I want to make the teacher to like me. Puts ungodly pressure on the kid, you know. And what if the kid, you know, so like everyone in the classroom raises their hand, maybe one kid doesn't. They say, well, my parents, I've thought about it, I'm not really sure yet. And the teacher says, okay, I see little Jimmy didn't raise, you know, whatever, little Timmy, little Susie, whoever, you know, our little friend here didn't raise their hand. Didn't raise their hand. Okay, great. So everybody else raised their hand. That's wonderful. You know, you guys are really, I'm really proud of you. I'm really proud of you that you're really up on the issues, you know, and our world's in good hands, you know, kids like you. And little so-and-so, you know, can you help us understand why you're not aware of this yet? Or is there, you know, what we're coming from on this? And, well, you know, the kid was under unbelievable peer pressure. Everybody's looking at them like they're like, what's wrong with you? You're some kind of idiot? Or you didn't get the memos or something? So this is ungodly pressure. Ungodly pressure. It's religious pressure. These religious catechism schools. Ferocious. And it goes all the way up through college. I mean, college is just absolutely nuts. It's an indoctrination mill. And our little friend who didn't raise her hand might say, well, I feel that this is really just a marketing campaign. The issue might be a fairly good one, but it's actually a religious campaign that's going on, marketing the belief that we're really human and that we can, that this is real and that we're really threatened. But my parents and I don't believe that we're really human. We're actually spirit pretending to be human. And all the kids are looking like, oh, this guy's completely crazy. We need to go see the the school psychiatrist or something. And the teacher will say, okay, make a little note, you know, we've got to send little so-and-so to see the school counselor and be evaluated. We need to have him evaluated here. Maybe there's some brain chemistry problem here. And let him see a psychiatrist, and he doesn't think he's human. He thinks that this marketing campaign is designed to convince us that, you know, we're human, and that's not right, and we're really spirit, and, you know, in other words, this little kid is right. Okay, he's the only one in the classroom who got it right. All the other ones failed. So I guess the teacher passes you if you fail. Failure is success. Failure is passing grade. And succeeding is a failing grade. It's completely upside down. Okay, maybe they got some brain chemistry issue going on there, and what kind of crazy stuff are the parents saying? We're going to have social workers look into this, telling the kid he's not human. This is like barbaric, you know, inhuman to say that someone's not human. Absolutely inhuman. So their ideology, their religion is to say it's inhuman to not claim that you're human, as if claiming that you're human is some wonderful boon, some wonderful thing. Oh yeah, I'm this bag of bones, going to be full of arthritis in several, you know, number of decades, hardly able to move around, aches and pains, can't sleep, you know, incontinent, and getting real, you know, getting all worse and illnesses and aging, and then dying. Teeth rotting and troubles and eyesight and senses going bad, you know, struggling and terrible struggles and strains and stresses in the world and disappointments. And, oh, yeah, who wouldn't want that? You got to be crazy not to think that that's wonderful. I mean, what a blessing. I'm a human. Oh, this is a tremendous blessing. Anyone who doesn't think it's a tremendous blessing must be completely insane. How about the ones say, no, I'm actually spirit. I'm perfect. I have perfect standing in reality. I'm absolutely flawlessly perfect, perfect freedom. And I don't need to pretend I'm human. I'm over that. They say, what? Oh boy, God, we got a complete crazy here. I'd better put them on heavy drugs so they can recognize what a how fortunate it is that they're actually mortal, human, frail, vulnerable. Our next breath is not even guaranteed at all. Our next heartbeat is not even guaranteed at all. Working ourselves to death here. And we don't, and we, you know, and of course, thinking that this is the best thing possible, we're so fortunate. Anyone who doesn't think that way is needs to be put in the loony bin. Certainly can't hang out with the other kids, it might contaminate them. So the teachers weed out those, you know, we don't want the classroom contaminated by any intelligence. Any, you know, this is religion. You know, you're not part of our religion. You can get out. So there really isn't any more education in the world, really. It's indoctrination now. It's indoctrination. And you lose all the clarity by doing this, you know. It's very bad indeed. So there have been gross distortions, gross exaggerations, bad science. It's all been politicized, you know, because it's the way to market a global dictatorship, actually. And a, you know, extraordinary control system for everyone's mind. Hive mind like situation here, and ultimately merging that with artificial intelligence, and so they're just trying to get people to go along with the agenda by trying to, you know, use some tactic that everybody can, oh yeah, we can relate to weather problems. Everyone knows we might have another ice age, actually. You know, but we humans have always adapted. Life on Earth has always adapted, will continue to do so. That doesn't sound good. Sounds like an actual interruption here. Good grief. Are you kidding me? Already the interruptions have become more aggressive, haven't they? You noticed that in the taping? If I were to become more aggressive. And not needing, don't need to do it. Don't need to do it. I'll have to listen to this one to see what's going on. But there's no need for all that. These interruptions are just very not emergency, you know, type of things that just are someone getting in the habit of it. Terrible. This is the way things are going now, isn't it? again, totally superfluous. Totally superfluous interruption. I have absolutely no necessity for that whatsoever. And so the people, you know, the New World Order simply don't recognize what we're doing at all. They've been conditioned, they've been absolutely brainwashed into thinking that their way is the only way, it's the right way. Anything other than that is completely crazy. This is to avoid realizing that they're going into a dead end, dark dead end. They project their own fear onto others that are not doing that and thinking that by saving them from what they're doing, somehow that what they're doing is righteous. Wow. They just don't, you know, to put it mildly, they just don't get it at all. They just really don't get it at all. And so we have to sidestep this. We cannot just be continually harangued and harassed and interrupted, you know, and not respecting the efforts you're making, that kind of stuff. So there's this terrible divide that's taken place in the world because of these very fearful people who, you know, are too afraid to even begin work on the continuity fear. You know, so they're not even beginning, not even kindergarten. And we can't have them running, you know, the educational system that people not even started kindergarten, you know, spiritual kindergarten, not even started it. So refuge is already here. Our perfect refuge is already right here, right now. We've already taken refuge in it. Our perfect refuge is already right here, right now. We've already taken refuge in it. Thanks be to the Holy Spirit, the one in charge of all of our freedom from time, space, process, and form, from this delusion of pretending. So thank you, Holy Spirit, for this perfect sanctuary you have provided us. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for this perfect sanctuary you've already provided us. We feel so fortunate and we feel so grateful, Holy Spirit, that we've already been able to take refuge in this perfect sanctuary that you have provided for us. Let's say people are on an island and the volcano is about to explode and blow the whole island to pieces, and you get on a ship and you're, you know, and people say, why are you getting on the ship? I said, what do you mean? I don't need to explain why I'm getting on the ship. You need to explain, why are you staying on an island with volcanoes about ready to blow it to smithereens? Why are you not getting on the ship? You're the one that's got to explain that. Why? It's stupid, crazy. I don't have to explain why I'm doing something that's totally reasonable. That's unreasonable to insist that those who are doing something that's totally reasonable, you know, explain in terms, you know, as if they're trying to explain something that's unreasonable. That's ridiculous. So, no. I already know why people are not taking refuge, so I don't have to waste any time. They don't have to explain it. I already know, but I certainly don't have to explain why am I taking refuge from insanity. I mean, why does anyone have to explain that? That's unreasonable to ask someone to explain that. You know, taking refuge from insanity is just obvious. Taking refuge from you know, being marketed to go into a dead end, you know, is just obvious. You don't have to explain. Explaining makes it less clear, you know, less clear, which is what they want. And certainly don't get into arguing with anybody. Now, let's say you're on the dock and there's this cruise ship there, this ship that's sanctuary ship, that's you're a refugee. I mean, and from this island, the volcano's gonna blow, and you're getting ready to get on the ship, and somebody stops you before you get on and say, "Hey, what are you doing? Why are you getting on the ship?" You know, justify what you're doing, and you get some big argument with them, and then meanwhile the ship has already sailed. You look up, it's gone, and then boom, the island blows. You know, this is stupid. So don't get into any arguments with anybody while you're getting on the ship. You don't need to explain anything. You're doing what's completely obvious to do, and they're not, because their continuity fear is, you know, they're still trapped in continuity fear. That's why they're staying. It's plain and simple. I'm getting on the boat because I'm recognizing it's the obvious thing to do, and you're not, because you're not recognizing it's the obvious thing to do because of continuity fear. I already know the answer, and so there's nothing else to say. And you see, the people are staying. They know they're doing something wrong, but they're not able. They feel trapped, and they don't know any alternative. But they want to feel right about their decision. I feel a lot better if you stayed here, because then that would reinforce my belief that I made the right decision. And I said, "Well, you didn't make the right decision. So that would just be, you know, bad precedent to stay. And you didn't make it because." Continuity fear is too extreme. You've not yet decided to get serious about it, serious enough about it. Keep thinking that there's some way around it by making pretense real. Well, arrogance, continuity fear is still in control. It's basically, it's continuity fear is still in control. This is the problem. And it's doing your thinking for you, you know. It does your thinking for you and then claims that you're the one doing the thinking. But really, you're just agreeing. Say, "Oh, okay, I'll agree with that line of thought." But you have to say, "Wait a minute, I don't agree with that line of thought." If you do that in your mind, you notice like your mind will be saying something, like I'm giving you advice. You say, "No, wait a minute, that's not right." Well, who's doing the thinking? Continuity fear is doing the thinking. But it's telling you that you're doing it. You're not doing it. Ultimately, we are, because we're the ones doing the continuity fear. But as far as the sequence goes, it's continuity fear that's giving rise to the thinking, and then you just think that you just came up with it independent of continuity fear, and that you're doing the thinking. But it's not that way, no. So continuity fear for most people just running their lives. And we're just passively letting it happen. But when you start to turn things around, you start to notice, say, "Wait a minute, that's not right. That's bad logic. Where's this bad logic coming from? That's bad advice. Where's this bad advice coming from? Why am I thinking this way? This is not what I really want to think. I don't really want to think this way. Why am I going here with these people? I don't really want to go here with these people. Why am I delaying? Why am I in this argument? I don't want to be in this argument. What's going on? What's in control of my life here? I don't feel I'm in control of my life the way I want to be." Well, it's continuity fear is in control of it. And those who don't do full stop in the wow, what happens is they keep asking more questions. You might answer something for them, and they, wow, the wow is so severe. And they think, okay, I don't feel right. What's going on? I'm a little bit worried, nervous. Let me ask a whole bunch of other questions. And they try to trip you up, ask more and more and more and more, as if to make the first answer wrong. And then they say, oh, they get rid of the wow by just saying, oh, it was wrong. This is not spiritual practice. Spiritual practice, you say the truth and you realize it's true, and then you allow the wow and you accept the wow, and you stop your activity, and you just let it reverberate. This is right spiritual practice. So I've already taken refuge in our perfect sanctuary, in the perfect sanctuary that is flawless in all aspects. There's the absolute picture of flawlessness, absolute ideal of flawlessness. I've already taken refuge in this sanctuary. And the intensity of these times causes people to take refuge in what they're most familiar with. So what I'm most familiar with in now is spiritual practice of asserting that I've already got exactly what I want. It's already here, right now. It's already right. I take refuge in right here, right now-ness. A sanctuary, it'd be a sanctuary. It has to be right here, right now. It has to be complete. To be a true sanctuary, it's perfectly flawlessly complete. And how can that, a completeness has to be right here, right now, doesn't it? If we overlook right here, right now, we can't see it at all. It's always right here, right now, complete. There's no precursor, there's no process to be complete. It's complete right here, right now. Inherently so. So we have to tune into right here, right now-ness. This is what we've been overlooking. My sanctuary is right here, right now. Say that. My sanctuary is right here, right now. My sanctuary is totally complete. Right here, right now. My sanctuary is the total completeness of right here and right now. My sanctuary is the total completeness of right here and right now. My sanctuary is the total completeness of right here, right now. My sanctuary is the total completeness of right here, right now. Now, some people are taking vacations right now. This is what they feel they can flee the trouble somehow. If you have money, a lot of people do that. Other people will immerse themselves in work. You know, everybody's going to try. But we're here practicing. My perfect sanctuary, my perfectly complete sanctuary is right here, right now. I'm tuning into right here, right now. My sanctuary is right here, right now. My sanctuary is right here, right now. Again, keep in mind that all delay is also right here, right now. All space is also right here, right now. All time is also right here, right now. All form is also right here, right now. All process is also right here, right now. Everything is actually right here, right now. Sam, I'm going to delay 3 days. Where is that delay happening? It's happening right here, right now. This is when we decided it. And the delay is right here, right now. There's not a delay on the delay. There's not a delay on anything. Everything is being experienced right here, right now. Is space some distance from right now? Is any place somehow distant from right now? Is any moment distant from right now? Are thoughts about the future, aren't they right now? Isn't whatever we call some sort of process, isn't that taking place right now? Is there some process that doesn't take place in the now? Is there anything that doesn't take place in the now? Is there any dance that's not taking place in the now? Are thoughts of the past, are they not taking place in the now? Here and now? Isn't all space here and now? Now, if we talk in relation to the body, you know, but that's a different story, you might say. But if we talk about it as a fact, as a mental fact, isn't all space here and now? Wherever it is, you know, the here-ness, it's where it is. It's here. We're not referencing the body. I mean, right here where this body is. Where the space is, it's here and now. It's not somewhere else. Isn't everything here and now? So if everything is right here and right now, can't we make a change? Isn't that also right here, right now? Take sanctuary. Isn't that also right here, right now? Yeah, you just have to let this sink in. At any rate, those kind of things can dawn upon us. We're just touching upon them. So my perfect sanctuary is right here, right now. My perfect sanctuary is right here, right now. I'm not imposing a future upon it. I'm not imposing an incompleteness upon it. I'm not imposing a process upon it. I'm not imposing a distance upon it. It's right here, right now. My perfect sanctuary is right here, right now. My perfect sanctuary is right here, right now. My perfect sanctuary is right here, right now. My perfect refuge is right here, right now. My perfect refuge is right here, right now. My perfect refuge is right here, right now. Just keep asserting this truth. My perfect refuge is right here, right now. There's really no place else for it to be. As long as we keep thinking it's somewhere else, then we'll keep praying and petitioning, oh, please, can you please get me this, my refuge? It's not here, right here, right now. Bring it to me. No, that doesn't work, because it is right here, right now. Everything that arises is right here, right now. So the refuge is right here, right now also. Don't try to delay on it. All we're saying is we're not. If we do that, we just say, well, we're not ready for it. We don't really want it yet. Make the excuse, but we do want it now. We do want it, so it's right here, right now. It's right here, right now. It's right here, right now. I'm experiencing my perfect refuge right here, right now. I'm experiencing refuge in my perfect sanctuary right here, right here, right now. I am experiencing perfect refuge in my perfect sanctuary right here, right now. Now, these attempts may seem futile because our bad habits are so ingrained within us and the continuity fear is so strong. We want to keep pretending as if we don't know how to do this, but we just have to keep persisting at it. We just have some very, very badly ingrained habits that are held in place by continuity fear. I am experiencing refuge in my perfect sanctuary right here, right now. I'm already having the wonderful experience of taking refuge in a perfect sanctuary, which is right here, right now. I'm already experiencing it right here, right now. So I don't have to think about it. I don't think I have to think about how do I get it or anything like that. Thoughts go quiet because I'm already experiencing it. So practice this as if you are already experiencing it. This is super important practice. Practice as if you are already experiencing it. A lot of strain, no, a lot of stress, no question. It was fine. It's go time, so you know this is a workout. A lot of wow here. Wow. I'm already experiencing the peace of refuge in my perfect sanctuary. I'm already experiencing peace. The peace of taking refuge in our perfect sanctuary that is right here, right now. I'm already right here, right now, experiencing the peace that refuge, taking refuge in our perfect sanctuary provides me. Now, it may not feel like peace right now. It may feel like the gears are grinding because we're trying to shift gears. When we're not used to shifting gears, we're going to grind the gears a little bit. That's okay. You've never driven a stick shift before, you're going to grind some gears. But, you know, pretty soon you get to learn how to shift smoothly. I am the now. I am the now. So nothing can actually touch me at all. Everything arises in the now. I am the now. There's nothing outside of me. It's impossible. Okay, so we just walk, taking this in stride, saying, okay, more practice, more familiarity. Most intense week of world history is coming up right now. And the world will never be the same after it. Fundamental turning point in world history. World will never be the same after this week. And it doesn't matter because we've already taken refuge in the Holy Spirit's perfect sanctuary. Where we get this, we begin to feel this experience of knees tried to hit me real strong there. The experience of having perfect standing in God, that all has perfect standing in God. There is no status issue at all. So we can't gain or lose anything. So this whole notion of gaining or losing, which we're so freaked out about, it is much ado about nothing. So of course this is work. This is very good. But what better work is there to do? You know, how can we let a day slip by and not doing this type of work? Crazy if we do. We feel like we've been lazy. We really spend a very lazy, extremely lazy, if we let a day slip by without doing this type of intense work. How can we be so lazy? It's a shame. It's a pity. We're just hanging out here in the wow of this is very intense practice. I've already taken refuge in the right here, right now. In the right here, right now-ness of the perfect refuge, sanctuary of the Holy Spirit. It's already here. It's already now. 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 Very important to emphasize this. It's already here. It's already now. The idea certainly is here now, isn't it? And we don't have to interpose any delay upon the idea and its expression, do we? No. Any delay we interpose, that too is an idea that is here and now. Idea of delay. So an idea of delay doesn't really bring up time-space process form at all. It does not. The idea of time-space process form doesn't bring up actual time-space process form at all. Just an idea right now. So how difficult is it to change an idea right now? There's no delay in any idea. So why should there be any delay in deciding, choosing another idea? Idea there can't be. There can't be any true delay at all. So the idea of refuge is also right here, right now. I am right here, right now. All is right here, right now. There's only right here, right now. I am not separate from right here, right now. The idea of separation is right here, right now. All is right here, right now. All is always right here, right now. Our sanctuary is right here, right now. Again, we're not used to thinking this way, so it puts a real strain on our overall psyche. Just sit very still so you don't feel like you have to do anything. And just be aware of the strain and just not fixated on it, but just a general awareness of this. I feel a little stressed out by this. I mean, just be confident, sit quietly, still, be confident that this will, I can absorb this, I can get used to this. I will, I've already used to it. I can get used to it, I will get used to it, I'm already used to it. I can get used to it. I will get used to it. I'm already used to it. So as you stay very still like this, the stream begins to calm down. See, if you start struggling with something else when you're feeling this strain, you're going to sort of panic inwardly and you get really jangled. This is very strong strain, so you want to just let it be just this and nothing else. So don't struggle when you're struggling. Don't struggle with the struggle. Because it will certainly affect everything else you do, and then you'll feel that you're struggling with all these other things. And undermines your confidence. You don't want that. We don't want this at all. So we want to sit very quietly, committed to not taking any action. Just sitting quietly, and then we allow the strain begins to gradually subside. Like a big wave washes into shore and, you know, leaves a lot of water in the beach and everything, and it takes a while for all the water to sink in and the wave to all that water to recede out, you know. Just let it recede, and after a while the beach is fine again. try to not let the mind wander. Keep it right here, right now. So, realizing that you can handle the stress of the strain of this is, you know, provides tremendous momentum. You prove it to yourself and say, wow, wasn't so bad, I can handle it. Got through it. So I've already taken sanctuary. I'm already protected from the marketing campaign. I'm already where I want to be, really want to be. We don't have to film the details. It's just practice the basic outline of it. The details will fill in themselves. Once you give the basic outline of what you really want. Sitting quietly in the full stop in the wow mode, just letting the wow gradually dissipate. Just flooded the land, letting the water subside, gradually subside, sink in and subside. This is how we make genuine progress. Flood yourself with the truth. Let yourself be flooded with the truth, and then let it subside. So by pre-stressing ourselves like this, when the most stressful week of history takes place, which it, in watching this video will now be underway, you say, wow, you know, I'm already pre-stressed and I can just continue on, you know, practicing that, you know, asserting that I've already taken refuge, keep on believing it. I can keep on this way. And so I feel confident. Doesn't matter what happens in the world. Whatever happens, I'm taking refuge from it. I'm taking refuge from this marketing campaign, which is certainly, the pressure is certainly going to be on. I'm taking refuge from it. I've already taken refuge from it. I'm already saved from it. this wow is really, you know, breaking the ice so strongly. Which is, you know, once the ice is broken, it's broken. So you can say, well, I've already broken the ice on this. You know, so it's, now it's a lot easier for me. I've already broken the ice on this, so. All right, well, I could stretch this out to 2.5 hours or whatever. There's no need to. Maybe we can do a little cool down period here. So our focus is not on what happens this week, but how much progress can we make towards accepting that our refuge is here and now, that we do have a perfect refuge right here, right now. How much progress can we make towards that, and whatever other progress occurs to us? How well can we do that? This is our challenge. And don't worry if you feel that you can't really explain anything to people, because that's the continuity. Our wow is still so strong that we project it a little bit and think that, you know, other people are difficult to deal with. Not really, because once the wow dissipates, you'll find that you'll feel very confident in dismissing any difficulties, actually. I've experienced this when the wow has finally calmed down. Oh my gosh, I'm so confident, it's just astonishing. But I keep pushing the wow, keep pushing, so rarely do I feel, rarely am I without this wow, strong wow, reverberating. So I always feel a bit insecure in trying to deal with situations, because the wow's so strong, I don't know quite, you know, I'm it kind of makes it difficult to feel really confident. But that's okay. I just avoid trying to explain anything to people who are not, you know, who are resistant to it and trying to change my mind. And just keep working on it. So if you feel like, you know, like, wow, I feel insecure, it's because of the wow is so strong. That's why. You know, we just broke the biggest taboo. Like, you can't practice this way. That you can't say that your spiritual sanctuary is right here, right now. You know, we just broke all these taboos, mental taboos that have been, whole, you know, keeping us like prisoner for so long. Well, this is a huge shock to the psyche. It's an elation and an trepidation and just big wow. Then I actually did it. Mm-hmm. Good news is that once we get through all this, we won't have to go through it again. That's the good news. You know, once it's done, you know, once it's done, it's done. So we're willing to put up with the temporary, you know, difficulty and understand, you know, when you're running a race, you're going to be breathing fast and, you know, feeling tired and everything. We all know that. So once we're finally finished, then we can cool down, calm down, and catch our breath. All right. Very great. Hope everyone's doing well. Insist upon it. Wherever you are, insist upon it. You're doing great. You've already taken refuge in the flawless perfect, to the finest detail, spiritual sanctuary that gives us absolutely all the protection that we desire and really want from any and all marketing campaigns and pressures, and moves us towards ultimate salvation. And so we're happy about that, grateful about that. Stay confident, glass half full. Stay confident, stay assured. Be of good spirit, be of good cheer. We don't have to react to anything that happens in the world. We've already taken refuge from it. I guess everybody's refugees now, right? I mean, we're refugees too, right? Except we're finding a much more hospitable situation than those in Europe, right? we're spiritual refugees. We're fleeing a battlefield. Marketing campaign is really a battlefield for your hearts and minds, ideological battlefield. So we're fleeing that battlefield. And, you know, anticipation, just like these refugees in Europe saying, hey, if I stay in my home, I'm likely to be annihilated because these, you know, the war is just raging here. So let's get out of here while the getting is good. Let's not mess around. So, you know, respect to all those refugees who had the guts to say, I got to get out of here. So we have the guts also to say, I got to sidestep this marketing campaign because this could bust my momentum very severely. And certainly we don't want to do that. Because then we'd be left with this hideous belief that we have to make pretense permanent somehow just by believing in it and disbelieving in spirit, which is, you know, a hideous, hideous existence, absolutely hideous. So we don't want to subject ourselves to a marketing campaign that's designed to turn our experiencing into some hideous nightmare. Not at all. We don't want to do that. So we're refugees, 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 but we have a perfect place to stay, so to speak. Absolutely we do. We already have it. We've already taken refuge there. We're already experiencing it. Just keep asserting that. We're already experiencing it. And it's wonderful. Now we may not be perceiving it yet. The fullness of our awareness might be up there, but we're easing into it. This is how we ease into it. So be fully confident that I've already taken refuge right here, right now, in the Holy Spirit's perfect sanctuary from this very ill-conceived marketing campaign that nobody really wants. They're just confused as to how to get away from it, but we're not confused about that. Very few mosquitoes because there's no water anywhere here. That's one benefit of this dryness. Very little standing water anywhere. So be patient with yourself during this week. Very patient. Don't retreat into your customary mode of old modes of stress reduction. I have to watch that too, of course. You don't go for the food, you don't go for the music, you know, you just stay away from stuff that, and you just rest, you know, if you need to, just take a rest, sleep for a couple hours. Just keep refreshing yourself. Practice, refresh, practice, refresh, practice, refresh, like that. And you'll be astonished, you know, how far you've gotten. And looking back in hindsight at some point, you know, you just say, wow. This is absolutely great. Rest and refresh, and then practice, refresh and practice. Don't overtax yourself this week. Just, you know, take it all in stride. Don't fixate on the news. Don't get involved in what's going on in the world. There's already, you know, intense pressures. Don't need to subject yourself to it. Just stay with the program. Stay with the practicing. And now we'll see what the dreams are like tonight. I don't know. So it's going to be pretty, very, very interesting. Usually, I tend to get notified a couple days in advance of all sorts of stuff. And so it could become very, very interesting the next few days. A few nights, rather. So we thank the Holy Spirit for the providing the sanctuary for us that's already here and already now. It's already here now. We're thankful that it's already here now. In a flawless way. It's already flawlessly complete here now for us. So we're practicing thankfulness for that. And stay subdued, stay humble, stay subdued. Don't get into rambunctiousness. That's a defense. I'll try to remember that. Just stay calm, subdued, sober, hardworking, humble, lowly. And just keep working at it, keep working at it. All right. Full stop in the wow, continue. And we will see how this week will go, right? And we will beat the week to the punch. We'll still be ahead of it. We're already ahead of it. That's what we do here. All right. Very great. That's it for this video.